God bless you. God bless you. This is Bishop Anderson coming live on Bishop Corner. You know, this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. And let the Redeemer of the Lord say so. Truly, beloved, we thank God just for another opportunity to live stream at Bishop Corner. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. This is Bishop James F. Anderson, Jr., presiding prelate of New Shiloh Holy Hands Healing Ministry, with my wonderful wife, Beverly Louise Anderson, as a pastor. And we truly thank God just for the opportunity and for the means to continue to reach out to the saints of God and also to those that haven't accepted Christ as their personal Savior. But we pray that through the hearing and teaching of God's word, that a soul might be saved. One lost soul might be saved. For the scripture tells us that the man left his 99 sheep in the fold to go and look just for that one lost sheep. That's how precious a soul is in the eyesight of God. So we thank God again for this medium to be able to get his word out to the live streaming audience. But before we go into our lesson on today, I'm going to give you a minute to think about what the subject is. Let us bow our hearts in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne. Thank you for your grace, for your grace is sufficient. Your strength is made perfect in our weakness. And Lord God, as we attempt to give your word on this evening, we ask you, Lord God, just to anoint it, that someone's heart may be changed, set free, and delivered. Bound the hand of the enemy, let self go down. Speak clarity to our hearts, so that the people can have a listening ear to receive your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And one for the Holy Ghost. Amen. Truly, we thank God just for this chance, beloveds. Did you figure out what the subject is today? Okay. Yeah. Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. This was the question that Jesus' disciples asked him. For oft-time, Jesus would still away and pray to his Father, which was in heaven. Oh, yes, Jesus has a Father. And the disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray in Luke 11 and 1, even as John taught his disciples to pray. And we're going to get a little bit into that, how to pray, teach us to pray. Prayer is something that you have to be taught, beloveds, how to do. In the old church, oh, how we miss the old church. Even though we are the old church, but you don't want to, you miss the old church. This new church is a little bit different, a millennium different. And you have to deal with them. You have to meet them right where they at, you know. Like the scripture says, old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. This is a new generation. And you have to be a wise fisherman. You see the fish just swimming up the river, they call salmon, how they try to swim against the tide. This is how this generation is. They swim against the tide. But the Bible says, wise is he that winneth souls. So even though the fish in this generation is going against the tide of traditional, or how things are normally done, you have to be wise, for wise is he that winneth souls. For they are yet souls. And God yet cares, and God yet loves them. That's why Jesus died on Calvary's cross over 2,000 years ago. For all this fish that's trying to swim against the tide. So, in James 5 and 6, it's 16, it says, confess your faults one to another. And we all have sinned, beloved, so we all have come short of the glory of God. You remember when you was young? You was young and dumb, you remember. And as you got older, you got a little bit wisdom. People oftentimes say, Lord, why did you give wisdom to the old and didn't give any to the young? Yeah. He said he called the young because they're strong and the old because they know the way. So if the young would listen to the older ones, their life would be so much better and so much easier. So James said, confess your faults. Confession is good for your soul, but you have to be careful who you confess your faults to, because some people, all they want to do is spread, instead of spreading the gospel, they want to spread the gossip. bad news in, bad news out, garbage in, garbage out. And he said, pray for one another. See, if I'm confessing my faults to you, beloveds, you ought to be praying for me, just like it's reciprocated. If you confess your faults to me, I ought not to be running in and telling my homie or telling someone else about your business. He said, pray for one another. And you pray for one another, beloved. In James, he said, that you may be healed of that fault that you have in your life, whatever it may be. Then it said, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. My subject is, Lord, teach us to pray. So the Bible is letting us know right here from the get-go, beloveds. The first thing you want to do before you go into prayer is you want to confess your faults to God. Lord, I sin. God, I'm a sinner. Whatever your fault may be, you want to confess. You want to go to the throne of God repenting. Humble yourself before the mighty throne of God. Then the scripture says that you may be healed. So my subject is all about prayer. We talked about the consequences of not receiving Christ into your life. Either if you receive him, you're going up to heaven, to the marriage supper of the Lamb. All these lessons are interconnected, beloveds. And if you don't receive him, I had a picture of one soul leaving up in a rapture from Las Vegas, Sin City. It said hell will be your home. And a lot of people don't want to hear about hell, and we're not going to teach so much about that on this evening. But these lessons are intertwined, beloveds. If you want to make heaven, you have to confess your faults to God so that you might be healed. So my subject is about prayer. In the old church, used to sing a song, Saints Don't Stop Praying. For the Lord is now, church, don't stop praying, hear your cry. For the Lord has promised and his words are true. Church, don't stop praying. Hear answer, y'all don't care how hard your problem may appear to be. R.W. Chambeck, he was a great evangelist, used to run tent meetings. He used to say this saying, you don't have any trouble. All you need is faith in God. And prayer will help you to have that faith in the God of eternity. So this is what we basically want to talk about. It's time for the church to pray, beloveds, like never before. For these are the times that try men's soul. In Luke 18:1, it said, men are to always pray and not to faint. I don't care what your trouble is, what your problem is. Prayer is the key to the kingdom, beloveds. Oh, yeah. And your faith in your prayer to God will unlock the door. So the big question is today, what is prayer? And I'm glad you asked that question. Prayer is communicating or talking or speaking to my God with an open heart, with a heartfelt heart, with a broken and a contrite heart. I'm just opening up my heart to God and say, God, you hear me. Lord, I'm a sinner. In sin, did my mother conceived me, created me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. This is what prayer is, communicating to God. Instead of getting on the telephone and telling your friends about yourself, about others, tell God about you, yourself. The songwriter says, have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles. He'll hear your humble cry, because the broken and contrite heart, my God, won't despise. He'll answer by and by. Don't you feel the prayer will turn? Don't you feel that fire burning? Have a little talk with Jesus, beloveds. He'll make it all right. Now, a lot of people, instead of talking to Jesus, they go on and talking to the psychiatrist who's charging them $75 an hour, every half an hour to hear your problems instead of going to the one who can heal and deliver you from your problems. The psalmist said, I'm going to lift my eyes to the hills from which comes my help. For my help comes from the Lord who made the heaven and earth. Because he don't slumber, he don't sleep. And guess what? You say, what? He's not going to charge you $75 an hour to sit on the bench on that couch and ask you the question, what do you think? And before you know it, you answered all your own questions and you paid that individual $75 to ask you the question, what do you think your problem is? So, in Luke 11:1, this is the scripture that we're mainly going to hone in on today. And it reads like this, and it came to pass that as he was praying, Jesus prayed. If Jesus had to pray, what about you and I, beloveds? Men ought to always pray and not faint. And he prayed, the Bible says, in a certain place. See, one of them certain places that Jesus oftentimes went and prayed at was the Garden of Gethsemane. He went into that garden. He had a set place, a set time where he would go pray. And the Bible says sometimes how he would rise up early in the morning just to go pray a great while before day. So they by asleep, they don't have time. Even the devil, he's lazy. He don't have time to chase you. And he would get a prayer through. The Bible says that when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray. As John also taught his disciples how to pray. They wanted to learn how to pray. Evidently, they had heard the master praying. And the prayers that they heard, no doubt, was just touching their heart. And oftentimes in the scripture, Jesus prayed. Yes, he did, beloveds. It says, all things give thanks, but this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Men ought to always pray and not to faint, beloveds. When Jesus fed the multitude with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread, what did he do? He prayed. Then he broke the bread. He gave to his disciples and said, feed the multitude. Have them sit down in groups of 50. And the Bible says how there was 12 fragment baskets left over, one for each disciple. When Jesus raised up Lazarus from the dead, what did he do? He prayed to his Father. He said, Father, I know you hear me always, but not for me, Lord God, but for those who are listening. Answer my prayer. And he cried out, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came forth. So today, beloveds, I want to break down to you how Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. And this is what he said, beloved. He said in the second verse of the 11th chapter of the book of St. Luke, he said unto you, when you pray, this is what I want you to say, our Father, which are in heaven. Yeah, so we're going to be reading this over and over again as we teach this lesson, however long God gives me to teach it. Our Father is truly, beloved, Abba Father. The first thing he's saying to God is, you're my Father. And it's my Father's good pleasure, beloved, to give you the kingdom of God. And where is my Father located? I'm not talking about my earthly Father, but I'm talking about my heavenly Father. Our Father, which art in heaven. Then he says, holy is your name, Jehovah. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord my provider. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord my peace. Yeah, Jehovah God. He's saying, holy is your name. And the angels in heaven, what do they say all the time? 24/7, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Then he goes on to say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. So he recognizing that God has a kingdom. For the kingdom of this kingdom of our God will become the kingdom of this earth and of his Christ. So he's recognizing God not only as his father, that's one, not only as his name being holy. In the Jewish tradition, they wouldn't even mention his name. They would each call him Yahweh because his name is so holy. Then he goes on to recognize him as king. Is he your father? Is he holy? The Bible says, follow peace with all men and holiness without no man shall see the Lord. And is he your king? Then he goes on to the third verse and he said, give us. Before he began to pray for anything, he recognized the power and authority of the God who rules earth and heaven. He humbled himself before his Father. This is how we go to God in prayer. We don't go to God with a whole prayer list, what we want, but not my will, but your will be done. And when I think about the will of God, I think about how Jesus, again, when he had to go from judgment hall to judgment hall, when he was betrayed by Judas in the Garden of Gethsemane with a kiss, what was he doing? He was praying. And what was he praying? I'm glad you asked that question. Father, oh my Father, hallelujah, my Father, hallelujah. If it be thy will to let this cup pass. And when he went into the Garden of the Gethsemane, beloveds, to pray, he had three disciples, his inner circle, Peter, James, and John. He said, sit here and pray with me while I go yonder and pray to my Father. And the Bible says he went about a stone cast away, as far as you could throw a stone. And the Bible says he began to pray. And he prayed in agony. And the Bible says he prayed until sweat came down like great drops of blood. And he prayed a simple prayer. Father, if it be thy will, let this cup of suffering that I'm about to go through on Calvary's cross for the sins of the world, let it pass. If there's any other way that man can be redeemed without my flesh suffering on that cross, Lord, let this cup pass. Then he brings himself in. Then he says, not my will, but your will be done. And when he went to the disciples, he found them asleep. Then he asked them a question. Couldn't you pray with me just 1 hour? Sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer that calls me from this world of care. This robe of flesh I drop to rise to receive the everlasting prize. It was prayer that brought us faith, saved us far, beloved. And prayer will see you through. It has been prayer that have kept me saved these 47 years. For the prayers of the righteous, going back to the book of James, it availeth much. And listen to this, beloved. Somebody prayed for me. Who are you praying for? God laid me on their mind, and they took the time to pray for me. The songwriter said, I'm so glad they prayed, and they took the time to pray. I'm so glad that they prayed for me. And who was that person that prayed? I'm glad you asked that question. My mother, she prayed for me. When everyone else gave up on me, I'm sure other people might have been praying, but she took the time to pray for this lost soul. And the worst thing about being lost, you think you got it all together, you think you're all of that in a bag of chips, is when you don't even have a clue that you're lost. Wow. Have you ever gone on a trip, or especially men, they don't want to admit that I'm lost. and you start going around seeing the same thing over and over and over again. How can the blind lead the blind unless someone leads them? So somebody prayed for me, and I'm praying for you today, beloveds. Whoever you may be, that's, listen, this is what Bishop Corner is all about. Men ought to always pray and not faint. Going right back to the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed the same prayer three times. He prayed one time and he brought his will in. He prayed the second time and he brought his will in. His will. And he prayed the third time and he said, not my will, but your will be done. And that's when the soldiers and Judas came. They came where they knew. Judas knew where he would be. He knew that the Garden of Gethsemane was one of the favorite places, the crushing of the oil, where Jesus loved to pray. Yeah. And he went there with the soldiers and he said, Master, and he kissed him. And Jesus said, betrayest thou me with a kiss? Because Jesus was so common. He wasn't extravagant. He was just like you and I, that they could not tell who Jesus was. So Judas had to betray him with a kiss. And because he was prayed up, he said, friend, called Judas a friend, betrayest thou me with a kiss. And let me tell you something, beloveds. His love for Judas, which is as symbolic as for sinners like you and I. We all are Judases. We all have come short of the glory of God. When he called Judas friend, that must have pricked the heart of Judas so bad that Judas took them 30 pieces of silver, the price that you would pay for a slave. He took it back to the Sanhedrin and to the Pharisees and to the scribes, and he cast it down at his feet. I betrayed an innocent man. Because they were religious, didn't have a relationship with God. Their attitude was, hey, what's that to us? And his guilt condemned us so much because Jesus called him a friend. He could have called him a betrayer. He could have called him a lot of things. He could have called him a snitch. You're a snitch. In Philly, they say snitches get stitches. But he called Judas friend. And I touched the heart of Judas that Judas went out and hung himself. He couldn't repent of his sin. Because Jesus told Judas earlier, it was good that you not had been born. Yeah, he was the son of perdition, beloved. Then he goes on to say, give us this day our daily bread. This is the first time he asked for anything for himself. The bread of life, ask for daily bread. For man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Lord, give us that which we need every day. Jehovah Jireh, you are my provider. And Jesus said, I can't do nothing except my Father give me permission to do it. Except I receive it of my Father. I can't say nothing of myself. I can't do nothing of myself. The miracles that you see is because my Father gave me the permission to do them. He was a humble son. He was a humble servant. And the fourth verse says, and forgive us of our sins as we forgive everyone that's indebted to us. Even Judas that betrayed me. Even to Peter that's denying me. To the soldier who pierced me through my tender side, now came blood and water. To the soldiers who planted 72 thorns and placed it on my head as a crown. To the soldiers who pulled out the hairs out of my face and spit in my face. To the soldiers who gambled over my garments. Forgive them of our debts as we forgive everyone. Forgive us of our sins as we forgive everyone who's indebted to us. And when Jesus was on the cross of Calvary, beloved, if Jesus didn't pray this prayer, I believe that judgment would have came. For Jesus says, Father, forgive them. Forgive them, forgive them, forgive them. He's still praying on the cross. He's praying. During his suffering, he's praying for you and for me, for the sins of this world. He's yet praying. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In so much his prayer checked the heart of the centurion soldier and said, truly, this was the Son of God that I helped crucify on Golgotha's hill, the hill of the skull. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Then he closed on this prayer, and this is in Luke. And lead us not into temptation. For the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Delighteth in his way. In Psalm 23, it says, and he leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thou is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So the Bible teaches us, according to St. Matthew's, the 6th chapter, the 5th to the 14th verse, is where we're going to pick up when we get back together again on Saturday evening to teach you how to pray. There's so much to this lesson, beloveds, and we're just going to take our time with it. So far we went over Luke, the 11th chapter. We went over the in the book of James, the 5th chapter, about confessing of our faults. We went over Luke, the 18th chapter, how we ought to always pray and not to faint. And Lord's will, when we get back together on Saturday evening, Bishop Corner at 7 p.m., we're going to go over with Matthew's, the 6th chapter, the 5th to the 14th verse. So we thank God for this lesson on this evening. Lord, teach us to pray. And my goal is to teach you how to really get a prayer through. And it's a formula to it, beloveds. In the old church, and we're done, but let me tell you about the old church, because it's the old church that brought me through to this present day. And you never want to forget your history. You never want to forget the bridges that brought you over. But in the old church, they had prayer warriors. These saints could get a prayer through, beloveds. I don't care what your situation was, you had prayer warriors. Not only did you have prayer warriors, you had altar workers. You had those who would that labor with souls. They would just labor with souls all night long if they had to on the altar. This is the boot camp that I came through. It was like the Marine Corps. We were special forces. That's what I came through. We fast, we pray, we study God's word. And this is what brought us through to this perfect time. And all we tried to do while we yet have our time on earth, because eventually all the old pioneers are going on. And that's leaving us. My wife, my mother, my sister, my cousins that are saved to continue to teach that which was taught unto us. This is what God told Joshua. Like I foresaid, beloved, it's so much to the word. God told Joshua that as I was with Moses, I'll be with you. Only be thou strong and courageous. Teach what Moses taught, and you'll have great success. We're just teaching you that which the saints of God that's going on to glory toward us. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. We'll see you Saturday evening, Lord's will, at 7 p.m. at Bishop Corner for part two on Lord, teach us how to pray. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your words, for your word does the upright good in the heart. Lord, help us to apply your word to our everyday lives. Thank you for your word and for those who will hear and receive your word today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, beloved. Shalom, peace to you. May the word of God pierce your spiritual being. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. Saints, don't stop praying, for the Lord is nigh. Saints, don't stop praying, hear your cry. For the Lord has promised, and his words are true. Don't stop praying, he'll answer you. Church, don't stop praying, for the Lord is nigh. Church, don't stop praying, hear your cry. For the Lord has promised, and his words are true. Don't